Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to call the regular meeting of the Enfield Town Council to order. It's Tuesday, November 13th, 2012, 7 p.m. And if I can ask everyone in the audience to please stand for a prayer led by Councilman Tom Kensler, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Dear Lord, please guide us in our service for our town and the decisions that we are going to make in the future years to come, and that we make them with the intentions of serving our residents in our town to the best of our ability. Also, this week being Veterans Day celebration, please watch over all of our armed forces, those that serve our country, with a special remembrance to the United States Marines, who celebrated their 237th year anniversary last year, and for all they represent. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, Tom. And may we have roll call, please.
Councilman Kinsler.
Here.
Councilman Lee.
Here.
Councilman Mancini.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Here.
Councilman Stokes.
Here.
Councilman Arnone.
Here.
Councilman Bosco.
Here.
Councilman Crawley. Councilman Edgar.
Here.
Councilman Hall. Mayor Copen.
Here.
There's 9 members present, 2 are absent.
Next item is the fire evacuation announcement. In the event that the fire alarm sounds here at Town Hall, I remind everyone that we must evacuate the building. Closest exit would be to the rear of council chambers and out to the front of Town Hall. But if you choose to go out the side door to your right or left, we ask that you take the back set of stairs to the back side of Town Hall. Minutes of the preceding meetings, we've got 3 to approve. First would be the special meeting of September 24th, 2012.
So moved.
Moved by Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Mangini. Discussion. Sensing none, by a show of hands, all those in favor. Those opposed, any abstentions? All in favor. We have the special meeting of October 15th, 2012.
So moved.
Moved by Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Mangini. Discussion. Sensing none, show of hands, all those in favor. Those opposed, any abstentions? And we have the regular meeting of October 15th, 2012.
So moved.
Moved by Councilman Kensler, seconded by Councilman Mangini. He beat you to it, Cindy. Yeah. Discussion. Yeah. Sensing none, by a show of hands, all those in favor. Those opposed, any abstentions? And unanimous again. We have no scheduled special guests this evening, except for those that are in attendance in the audience. You like that?
That's nice. What are you saying? They're special?
They're our guests. And and I just did something to my iPad, and I need to get back to my page. So I believe, how do I get rid of this?
Here.
Oh, there we go. We go to public communications and petitions. If there's anyone in the audience wishing to address the council, I ask that you please raise your hand. I'll call on you. Please come forward to the front table, state your name and address for the record. Please keep your comments to no more than 5 minutes. And we ask that you please refrain from the use of personalities. Councilman Communications, yes, sir. Public communications, sorry.
Hi.
Hello.
I'm Alex Wood. I live at 30 Lake Street in South Windsor. I'm a reporter with the Journal Inquirer, and I had written a letter to Town Manager Koppler with copies to all the members of the council, simply requesting a sort of retroactive waiver of the $108 copy fee that the Journal Inquirer paid for records of the internal affairs investigation by the police department relating to former Lieutenant Dwayne Tompkins. The good news is I'm not going to repeat what's in that letter or even try to summarize it here. I simply wanted to ask the council personally to consider the request that we made and the reasons for the request. And I do think that if you consider this carefully, you may well reach the conclusion that compliance with the request benefit of the general welfare, which is a legal standard for granting the fee waiver that we requested. So I would just ask you to give that consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. Public communications, Mr. Sheridan.
Jack Sheridan, 7 Buchanan Road. I noticed that Enfield had a 70% turnout for the vote, and I think that's great. But when you check other states, they had 130% turnout, 118, 138, all over the map. And I'm wondering what the outcome would have been had that been legit. So I had a suggestion that maybe on our next referendum, we ask that only people who pay taxes are allowed to vote. I thought maybe that would fix that problem. And because the townspeople voted to approve the school additions and renovations, and because since then I see in the paper in the JI vote November 10th and 11th, it says that a dramatic plunge Friday in the state's anticipated revenue, and it goes on the deficit potentially approaching $300 million. And then it says down further, it says $145 million below the level assumed by Comptroller Kevin Colombo, reported $60 million deficit on November 1st. And it says, that's because revenues from most sources, taxes, fees, state's share of Indian casinos, receipts, are all down by $258 million this year. And then further down it says, put all that together and the budget deficit likely approaches or exceeds $300 million. So if the budget deficit is going to exceed $300 million. I'm wondering if the plans are still to go ahead with the school, because where are they going to come up with this $70 million that they promised us? I predicted a while back, if you remember, that they could go bankrupt in this process. If all these places that come up with and they keep raising taxes and driving business away. So I'm just wondering if we're going to reconsider what we might do. The school is approximately 14,000 square feet larger than recommended or by the state. And therefore, students' enrollment's dropping off by in excess of 200 a year. So by the time they open the doors, there's going to be a lot of empty seats in this school. And when you see empty seats, what do? You fill them. So we're busing in kids then. And I just wonder how many people in the town, when they voted for this, realized that that's what might happen. We have 68 kids being bused in now through the school system, so I can't imagine what it'll be like when they find out that we have many empty seats in the high schools. So, and then I asked the question, how many teachers are going to lose their job over this? And I was told by the school administrators that they weren't going to lose any jobs, and that it was going to happen through attrition. Well, that's a lot of attrition to pay for $30 million on our end on the bond. And I'm saying this tonight because I want it on record so that when all of this happens, we'll be able to go back and reference that the old guy was right. And the only other thing on tonight's agenda that I wanted to approach was $50,000 for a zoning study in Thompsonville. Come on, I'll study it for about $5. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Public communications? Anyone else? Very good. Thank you very much for your comments. Next, we'll move to Councilman Communications and Petitions, Councilman Mangini.
Thank you. I just had a couple of comments. It was refreshing to see the turnout and the participation of the Veterans Day Parade. It's important that we as a town come out and support our veterans. And I think especially that our youth are introduced to the concept of veterans and understand and appreciate what our men and women have and continue to go through to protect our freedoms. I do want to direct a question to our town manager through our mayor. There's a pothole on Southwood that has been there 3 months now, maybe, and periodically A-frame sign will stand over it, and then it disappears, then it comes back, and then it's gone. I'd like to find out if, in fact, it can be repaired or if there's a problem with it that we need to address. I'd also like to praise Suzanne and her staff. I worked the presidential portion of the election, and it was very pleasurable. It was very busy, but it was very pleasurable. And I say it was very pleasurable because Suzanne and staff, town staff, worked very hard and very diligently to accommodate all the people that came through. There were questions, there were, you know, concerns, but everything went very smoothly, and I attribute that to professionalism with our town staff and great leadership. And I just wanted to say thank you for that, Suzanne. That was wonderful to service the people like that. And then finally, I do want to comment about the food shelf. You know, we have Thanksgiving next week. There are 490, 510 families that are in need of food at the present time. Saturday and Sunday from 9 to 3, the food shelf will be receiving goods in the form of turkeys, sweet potatoes, stuffing, and cash. They need money. If people, you know, can get out there and support in any of those fashions, that would be very helpful. And I want to thank also the volunteers from the Enfield Food Shelf for all their hard work and providing for the people. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Councilman Kensler.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A couple things. One, through Scott to the town manager, there is a second request in by resident on no parking signs that are on Laurie Drive across from Woodacres Park that are faded so you can't read them anymore, and they were supposed to be replaced. They're on telephone poles. I believe there's three of them that come from Till Road down to Robin Road. If you could just have somebody take a look at that and see if they can just swap those out or repaint them. Secondly, although this past election week didn't go quite the way I wanted it to for some things, one of the things that did happen that was near and dear to my heart, and I think everybody on the council, was the passing of the referendum for the high schools. And I just wanted to take a moment and personally thank those that stepped forward and did, I don't know if the public really knows, the tireless work that they did to try to get as much information out as possible, to take questions and answer them, to take misinformation and correct it regarding what was happening, the reasons why, and the benefits to our children. But the members of that Enfield's Future PAC deserve a big shout out. They jeopardized a lot of their family time, a lot of ridicule, and they ended up by a wide margin getting, helping us get that passed for our children. So I wanted to thank them personally. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Tom. Councilman Arnone.
I had some pictures of the Veterans Day Parade today, courtesy of Tim Jensen, but unfortunately we had some technical difficulties. So next Tuesday, Tim, I'll make sure they get out and appreciate the use of those pictures. I just want to remind everybody again for Cookies for Camouflage, Sunday, November 25th from 11 to 3. They'll be collecting the cookies at the American Legion Post 80 downstairs at 566 Enfield Street. Just bags, Ziploc bags of cookies in a small box. If you have a couple bucks for postage, drop that by also. That's be a huge help. I've heard that it's just incredibly huge outpouring this year. They wanted to beat last year's 551 pounds of cookies, and I got a feeling they're going to do it. So I'd like to see everybody get out and do that one last push.
for them, it's a great, great thing for local veterans or local people serving. And that's it. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Tom. Councilman Bosco.
Yeah, I just want to congratulate Dave Kiner for the election. And I also want to try to put a challenge out for him is not to roll over like you did the other years. And we're in such a mess, David. You please have to just stand up and do something other than tax. And it's going to be some hard cuts, but it is what has to be happening. And I just ask and I hope and pray that we can get out of this mess. And again, nobody increases revenues with more taxation. So please, David, just keep an eye on it and help us out. Thank you.
You got it. I'm Joe Bosco.
Thank you, Joe. Councilman Communications, Councilman Lee.
One, just a kind of a shout out tonight and congratulations to the Fermi boys soccer team. I think he's playing in the their third state tournament game tonight. I believe it's the quarterfinals against Ram. And I believe so. I'll get a text here when the game is over, see how they wrapped up, and hopefully they keep moving on, and just wish them the best.
Great. Thank you, Bill. Deputy Mayor Nelson.
I just would like to make a motion to suspend the rules and move A1 and A2, B1, D, E, F, and G to miscellaneous and proceed to vote.
Second.
Motion by Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Mangini to move the four mentioned items to miscellaneous. Any discussion? Sensing none, by show of hands, all those in favor? Those opposed? Any abstentions? Items have been moved to miscellaneous. Anything else, Gunn?
That's it. Thank you.
Anyone else before I go? All right. Got a couple items. First of all, want to extend congratulations to the Enfield High School Safe Graduation Committee. They held their auction this past Saturday evening at Enfield High School, and it was well attended with a lot of auction items, and they exceeded their goal in fundraising. So it was a fun night at Enfield High School, and as some of you know, I place myself up for auction every year, dinner out, totally on my dime at a restaurant in Enfield for four people plus myself and whoever else I want to drag along, and it went for $200, so I thought that was pretty good. So it cost me a lot more than $200 at the dinner, but it's all for a good cause, so.
Priceless.
And
was the bidder blind?
No, and actually it was a pretty contentious bid back and forth. It was fun to watch.
Having won you before, I can tell that's a bargain.
That's right. Yes, you ran up that bill. You'll have one more chance this year, and that will be at the Fermi High School Safe Graduation Committee auction. I know. Stay away.
December 7th
at the Elks. I, too, want to thank the Enfield Veterans Council for the Veterans Day Parade and ceremony this past Sunday. Beautiful day. I think Ted Plamondon has an in with Mother Nature, and he made mention that only in the history of a Veterans Day Parade, there's only been two that have had rain, and which forced them indoors to an inside venue for the ceremony. So that's pretty good odds. That's good. But congratulations to all the veterans and the Veterans Council and everyone who participated in the parade. This afternoon, noontime, the town manager and I met with Chairman Tim Neville of the Board of Ed and the Superintendent of Schools. We're meeting quarterly. Monthly. Just to go over issues between the town and the school system. And most of our conversation centered around the passage of the high school merger referendum question and the process that we're going to lay out there for a building committee, hiring an architect, and that's where the main focus was. But we also started some conversations on revenue projections. Bill, you had put out an email today asking for where does the town sit revenue-wise based on the same information, Jack, that you had given during your comments we're seeing state revenues fall, and we want to get a check on town revenues and where we sit at this point in time in the fiscal year. And that will be at our meeting next Monday on November 19th. So we'll have a presentation from Lynn Nenny on our financial health. Speaking of the referendum, I too want to thank all the folks that were involved in the passage of question number one. And from council and board being unanimous behind the effort, to the great support that we received from town staff, from school staff, from the pre-referendum high school consolidation committee, and then the Enfield Futures PAC that took the ball and ran with the publicity, the signs, the advertising, and the advocacy through Facebook and other means. Just a congratulations to everyone involved. And we now have a school to build and a lot of work to do. And so we will be forming, the town council will be forming a building committee. And the plan, Matt's going to just go over his plan, but I'll trump him a little, is that we'll have, if we reach council consensus this evening to go forward with his plan, we'll have an application link up on the town's website tomorrow to the application for the building committee. Thoughts are comprised of nine residents with two alternates, two council liaisons, two Board of Education liaisons. And that application deadline will be either right before Thanksgiving or shortly thereafter, so that we can then appoint the building committee at our first meeting in December, which is December 3rd. And that group will get off and running and probably meet weekly for a period of time. And their major job, first task, would be to put out an RFP and hire an architect to bring the project forward. So if you are interested in serving, tomorrow morning, go to the town website, click on the link for the building committee application and submit your application into the town manager's office. And we'll do the same type of review and vetting process as we did for the pre-referendum high school consolidation committee, where Cindy and I will meet from the council with Tim Neville and Donna Suzak from the board. We'll review through and make our recommendations to the town council for approval. And we'll share all applications with you ahead of time. So that's the process with the building committee. Some events that are coming up. Cindy had mentioned the Enfield Food Shelf looking for turkeys. They're looking for the 12 to 15 pound frozen turkeys. They are accepting turkeys tomorrow, Wednesday, the 14th. And Thursday, tomorrow, Wednesday, from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., Thursday, the 15th, from noon to 6:30, and then on the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, the 17th and 18th, from 9 a.m. To 4 p.m. Of course, monetary donations, $15 buys the turkey. So please help out the Enfield Food Shelf. Thanksgiving has come up really quick, and it's very early this year, and I'm sure there's still a tremendous need for them to fulfill all the requests. Also coming up this weekend, Barnes & Noble is holding a book fair on Saturday, November 17th, and it benefits the Enfield Education for Excellence in Education, Enfield Foundation for Excellence in Education. Barnes & Noble Book Fair, they've got a couple authors coming in, a story time, and actually a presentation, Learn How to Defeat a Bully. Children ages 6 to 12 will learn how to de-escalate various bullying situations. The seminar will be taught by Sensei Janice Morton, a certified black belt instructor from Integrity Martial Arts. So Integrity Martial Arts is helping to sponsor the book fair, and proceeds from the book fair will go to Effie, but also something that Barnes & Noble is doing is they're actually holding a book sale or donate a book campaign. And you go to Barnes & Noble and you pick out a children's book and you fill out one of these little red cards and you deposit it, and the collection is going to Kite. And this is happening throughout the entire holiday season. I was over at Barnes & Noble a couple weekends ago, and it was for Connecticut Loves to Read Day. And so you can, I'll raise it. So it says donate today, and you can actually donate. I believe Shriners is one of the, there's two charities. One is Shriners, and one is Kite. So we'd love your support for being local. We'd love your support for Kite in the in their holiday book sale. And then my last item before a quick presentation, this also this Saturday, it's the Enfield Rotary Club Pancake Breakfast at the Enfield Senior Center, 8 a.m. to 11 a.m., the annual Pancake Breakfast for Rotary. And then if the camera can go down in front of my seat area, there's a framed picture mentioned at the council meeting, I believe one council meeting. We received about four or five different large pictures from Rich Tangway. And Rich Tangway lives in town. He owns a company called Videograms Digital Services. And he took pictures during the 4th of July celebration fireworks display of fireworks exploding over Town Hall. And so I passed the pictures on to the manager's office. And as Rich's donation to the town, we picked the photo. And Rich did the matting and framing. And there's either three or four other photos, and I think the town is going to have them matted and framed as well to hang in Town Hall. But just want to thank Rich. He's a great photographer. He's out around the community, and you'll see his work in the Enfield Press on Enfield Patch, and he loves to share his work. But this is a special donation. So, again, thank you, Rich. He didn't want to come and present it. He rather just to give it and let us plug him. So just appreciate all that you do for our community, Rich. And that is what I have. So we'll go to Matt for the town manager's report and communication.
Good evening. Are there any questions on my plan for the building committee?
Yeah. Good plan, Matt.
Anything else? You know, the mayor hit all the high points of it. We'll be bringing the actual establishment resolution to council on Monday of next week. I would anticipate at that point in time council will adopt it so we can officially start all the process on the referendum then. But 11 members in terms of voting capabilities, 9 of them are regular, 2 are alternate. We're looking at 2 non-voting representatives, liaisons from the Board of Education, from Council. And if everything goes right, there'll be a lot of work to be done starting in December.
Is that it?
That's, you know, you hit all the high points. There's nothing left for me. I'll say, if you have no objections, we'll start the advertising tomorrow morning.
Everyone's like the plan? Yep. All right, you've got consensus on that.
The only other item real quick I want to hit on is the Southwood issue. We are aware of a issue there. I know DPW has been looking to try to ascertain exactly what's causing it. They were looking at potentially a water line issue, or it could be a sanitary issue. You know, unfortunately for a sanitary sewer issue, that system right there is fairly deep. And it'll be an expensive fix for it. So they want to make sure before we start tearing roads up, we know exactly what it is that's causing that. So they are working on it. I know it's taking some time, but they will get that taken care of. Yep. And that's all I had.
That's all you have?
That's it.
Any questions for Matt? All right. Thank you very much.
Little Kevin gets going.
Yes.
I got to try to be shorter than that.
Town Attorney's Report and Communication, Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Other than the items that we discussed in executive session, I don't have anything formal to report. I will be meeting immediately prior to our next meeting with some of the Boy Scouts from Troop 2000 here at Enfield who are completing their law merit badge, and I believe if we can work it out, they're going to join us to lead us in the pledge afterwards. So that's one of the fun things we get to do occasionally in this job. Tell them not to go to law school and find a real job. Make an honest living somewhere. I should have listened to that advice myself, I suppose. But nothing.
That's it.
That's it.
All right. So. Questions or sympathy for Kevin?
Plenty of sympathy.
No questions. Okay. Next would be reports of special committees of the council. Any reports of special committees? None. We move to old business, and all old business stays on the table. We move to new business, and the only item under new business is the opening on the Ethics Commission, which we're still looking for a person who would like to serve. So that remains on the table, which moves us to items for discussion. All items have been moved to miscellaneous with the exception of item H.
So,
would you mind if I just pick up D for a moment off the table?
Which one? Back on?
On B.
Under items for
old
under
business.
Old business?
Yeah.
If you'd like to make a motion?
I would.
To remove the item from the table?
Yeah, please.
Seconded by Cindy. All those in favor by a show of hands? Those opposed? Any abstentions? Item's been removed from the table. Go ahead.
Yeah, just a quick update. I want to let the council know that I have, through the forum that Scott and the board chair have each month, I have initiated a good conversation with them and the superintendent, and they're interested in taking a strong look at this. And what the first step is going to be is a meeting that I'm going to set up with Chairman Neville to kind of review what it was last year that I had found online in various other places that looked to be either in conflict of what we were aware of or just the whole series of metrics that looked like they were coming in different places and the data that goes into support some of the state reports and so forth. So very, very long way to say that I'm still pursuing this, and once we have this meeting, the superintendent is going to get back to me and come up with a good course of action to review those, and as a board, we may be seeing, the Board of Ed may be looking to work with us to adopt, you know, performance metrics or financial metrics that we can both share and rely on. So that's where that is at the moment.
Okay, Cindy?
Bill, thank you for that update. Question I have for you, though, are you referring to the audit, or is this something different?
No, this was completely different. Right after the budget was adopted in May, I had gathered some data that the school system purports to provide to the state of Connecticut, and what we get in our budget book doesn't match at all what the state of Connecticut reports, and these questions were a response from me to the fact that very often in the budget process we start getting compared to different things around the state of Connecticut, around the educational ERG. And what I was finding is that looking at the state of Connecticut's website, where all this stuff is supposed to be rock solid data, I was pulling down statistics on the web page, on one web page that was coming up with two different results, and then comparing that to what we had in our own budget book, which was a third result. Compared that to what the school system has on their web page, it was a fourth result. So my goal in kind of raising my hand on this is that it sure would make everything run a lot easier and a lot more reliably if everyone kind of adopted the same set of data or at least the same set of metrics, and we can fight over where the data comes from. But if someone can tell us these are the metrics, could be 5, could be 105, that point to a healthy public school system, well, that benefits them, and it certainly benefits us as the fiduciary.
Okay, then my also question through Scott, or maybe back to Scott, we have kept this item on the table as a discussion item, development of school financial metrics. I guess my concern or question would be, at what point do we pull this off the table for that discussion? And I guess that's where I'm a little bit confused.
Scott, if I may, back in May, the initial intent was to Scott that if this is something we'd like to work with in partnership with the Board of Education, that once they're on board, a subcommittee of the council would be established and it would come off old business and be formed as a committee.
Okay, well,
I think we're probably a month from that happening.
I'd like, if it's good through our mayor, Scott, that we keep getting updates on the behind-the-scenes research that you're doing, because, again, I think at some point the council would probably want to, you know, review and discuss the pros and the cons and the validity and the acceptance of the materials.
Right. Well, that's why after the meeting last week, the first step was let's see what I had. Let's see if I was correct or incorrect in what I was assuming. And then the superintendent would...
And the Board of Ed chair.
And the chairman would determine if they wanted to be part of this subcommittee.
To validate the research materials.
We'll know right away if the data, what I've said is accurate. What would come out of that meeting is how do we go about establishing community standards that this board and their board share on the health of our public school environment, and they sound like they're already headed down that road. So I think in the meantime, you know, what they're reporting to the state and how it reflects back on us is what we're trying to determine the accuracy of.
Yeah, I think, you know, keeping the council informed is definitely a step in the right direction. Thank you.
A motion to retable.
Second.
Motion by Councilman Lee, seconded by Deputy Mayor Nelson to place this item back on the table. All those in favor by show of hands. Those opposed? Any abstentions? Items back on the table. Thank you, Bill. Okay. Ready to go to items for discussion. Item H, discussion zoning enforcement fine ordinances.
Council may recall several months ago, we had a special meeting where members from PNZ, the Board of Zoning Appeals, as well as Inland Wetlands made a presentation to council regarding the development of a couple different, what they were calling fines ordinance. The first was the zoning enforcement fines ordinance. And just to let you know, we've been working with the Development Services Subcommittee of the council on this, and they had a desire to kind of take these two fine ordinances one at a time, the first one being the zoning enforcement. For the most part, what you see before you is what was presented to council from planning and zoning. There were a couple of changes, although if you go to the red line version, there's a lot of changes in there, and there'll be some things that, you know, we did to make it coexist with existing law. But the two areas that were of major change from what was presented to us, the easier one of the two at the end, they wanted to afford some protection to the zoning enforcement officer, where they wouldn't be they would not be held liable for any actions that they took. You might be more familiar with the term, is it trouble, I think? Trouble
damages.
treble damages. Yes, that's the word I was looking for. However, the state legislature kind of took care of that for us. And so we at the time, before they actually did that, were looking at it and said we didn't really want to conflict with what the state was saying. But then they took care of it, so it's not an issue anymore. But that is one of the changes. The second, I think, big change is that they had presented something that would create the hearing officers to actually be members, I believe, of BZA. And as we looked at it and tried to line it up with what our current and what the state says that we can do for hearing officers, we felt that there may be a little bit of a conflict in having somebody, a member of the Board of Zoning Appeals, being a hearing officer, and would rather go through what we've established as the hearing process with individuals that we've selected to already hear on the blight and the snow removal, parking, and alarm ordinance, and felt that that, from our standpoint, is working pretty good, and it gives a very fair and balanced review of any of these type of claims.
Okay. Thank you, Matt. Bill, since you've been intricately involved in this process, do you have anything to add before we open up to the floor?
No, I don't. I mean, I think Matt kind of crystallized the two big areas that we had reviewed or made suggestions to during the committee review process. I think you just open it up.
Okay. So any comments, questions from the council? Sure. Councilman Arnone.
Yeah, I think anytime we get a teeth into a, you know, a law, it's a good idea. Helps the office zoning officer enforce, too. I think it's just a good way of going. Fully support it.
Thank you, Tom. Councilman Bosco.
I guess I'm just the opposite. I think that we have what's there is working now. Just because we lose a case doesn't mean we may need to make more teeth in something to nail more people. I just don't know where we're going, you know, with all these fines and ordinances and the stuff. I guess the land of the free is gone. And I'm not going to be one to put more burden on our people. Just look in most people's backyard, you'll find something wrong. May it be blight or anything, but look in your backyard, you'll probably find something.
Okay, Joe, thank you. Further comment, questions?
Yeah, just one. You know, the land of the free is great until it, you know, until this theater burns down because of faulty wiring. You know, and I think we have a responsibility as a council to make sure that health and safety of our citizens is first and foremost. Thank you.
Joey?
I don't want to go tit for tat, but if a shed is 1 foot over and all the neighbors around don't care, I don't think it's really the town's business to say move the shed a foot or knock it down. And that's where I'm going, because what right now is when we empower people with too many things and to the point that there's so much power that it tends to get abused, and things just start getting written up, and it can get out of hand. You know, and when you take the fear of someone that they're going to get in trouble if they do something that's wrong, and we're going to protect them, we'll also escalate bringing things in. So I'm just fed up. I mean, it just, again, if it's safety, I agree with you 100%. But if it's a little bit of moss growing on the side of your house, or the neighbor's shed is a foot over and they found out because they came come and did a reappraisal of your property, and now we make a big deal out of it, you know, and no one else cares around it, That's where I have my problem.
Councilman Kensler.
Through Scott to Matt, I just would, if you have this information or a feeling about it or could get it, I'm curious, the since we enacted this and compared to before, what your feeling is in regards to the percentages of neighbors, complaints, businesses that are complaining, bringing these to our attention, as opposed to our own people that are going out.
Or are you talking, because we haven't enacted this particular code yet. You're talking just about the blight?
Or? Just in the whole general, do you find that more of our complaints are being self-generated?
You mean us going out and looking for them?
Looking for them.
I think there probably are more than in the past, but I guess I wouldn't say that you know, we're going crazy out there. I mean, there's a lot more that could be cited, I think, given the time and the resources. But I think those things that are of immediate issue are being addressed. Yeah, it's a relative question.
Right,
because of staffing. I've been places where, I know you probably wouldn't want to be on council, some of the places where I was manager, because, you know, they were, you know, just even one thing that was wrong, you know, we were getting beat on to go out there and enforce it. So, I mean, you know, we're nowhere close to that. I know it may be by certain people be perceived that way, but I know for a fact we're not to that level. You know, this really, what we're presenting tonight and what was presented by P&Z, you know, I don't think necessarily makes us more aggressive in going after it. I think this helps address some long-term issues that aren't being resolved, but I don't think it makes us more aggressive or we're going to find more people violating the law. I think the way that I would expect this to be implemented is, rather than trying to go through the court system, which, you know, we're doing right now with different zoning issues, you know, we could use this one first and possibly get a resolution without spending a lot of time and effort with lawyers on both sides. So I think this helps, would help, if everything is done the way it's supposed to be done, you know, end issues that are, you know, big issues for different properties without having to go to court and spend all the time in court.
Yeah, the reason I'm glad you said that, the reason I bring it up is because I come at it from a fairness and a thoroughness, mm-hmm. that we're not, you know, perceived by anyone as skipping over something that's been maybe a problem for a while to get to something that might be easier to resolve just because it's easier to resolve. And then we're maintaining that, you know, fair equity throughout the process.
Yeah.
And I know you have a handle on that and we're watching it carefully, but for public consumption, I think that's important that people understand.
Yeah, I don't think that we are skipping over things that are in front of us. And again, that becomes, I mean, it's a very difficult balancing act that we're trying to do here, because, you know, our employees that we place in these enforcement positions, you know, make the oath to uphold the laws of the town of Enfield. And the reality is they can't enforce 100% of all the violations that are out there. There's no way to do it, because we could, you know, they might be able to go out and say this is a violation 100% of the time, but what it takes to actually enforce that and bring it to a reasonable conclusion, that everybody say, yep, that's fine. I mean, it just is impossible with the level of staffing that we have and the number of hours in a day. It just, yeah. You know, it's not going to happen. So, you know, by nature, enforcement individuals are going to be going towards the bigger ones that are, you know, either just so obvious that you know, you can't help but notice it, or ones that have garnered a lot of complaint and it's, again, very obvious that it's a violation. I don't think we're taking time right now to do those that you know, are questionable. I mean, in fact, you know, I know of a number of claims or cases that if you talk to the neighbors, you know, they're 100% sure that that's a violation. But when we went out to take a look at it, I mean, you know, it's the difference between, you know, unkept versus blight, if you understand that.
Yeah.
And if you live next to somebody that, you know, lives differently than what you do and has an unkept backyard where yours is spotless, that's blight. And so we're not very favorable to those residents because we're not doing anything to correct what they see as an issue. But you know, it's difficult for the enforcement people because, you know, they get the call. They're the ones that are going out and dealing with the residents on both sides. And it's a no-win situation for them. But, you know, that's the job that, you know, they took with us. So there's, you know, no feeling sorry for them. But it's not always easy, clear, and black and white what has to be done. And they're doing a very good job, I think, of walking that fine line.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Tom.
Yeah, Matt and I are going through one right now from an email of a resident that's in the fine stage. And it is still a very difficult process. And I think the town has handled it in, you know, a good way. They've weighed all the facts before it. And there's still an appeal process. And I think, we, you know, could take a second to review that you're still not going to get the fines if you're going to appeal. You can appeal your process. And it's a long, it's actually very difficult on staff, I think, more than it is anybody at this point to try to pinpoint which ones are very serious and which ones aren't. And I think you're doing a good job, Matt, there right now. And I know it's tough on a few people and residents right now, but it's not that easy to levy the fines. And through the blight ordinance as any example, it's been difficult.
And let me just say, you know, our goal is not to levy fines. You know, our goal is not to go to court. Our goal is to bring, you know, whatever the issue is into compliance. And you know, I know the one that you're referring to, you know, that one's definitely not a black and white issue. And it's, again, you know, no doubt it's impacting negatively the adjoining property owners. But, you know, there is question as to whether, you know, it is a violation. And I think that's why we have the zoning, or excuse me, have the hearing officers to make that ultimate decision. So.
Anyone else? Just for my comments on this, I know one of the pieces that we were looking for was to have that hearing process, and that when you look at the red line, that's what really the big change it puts in the hearing process, and that was a concern of the council. So I think that's a very positive addition to this ordinance, and I thank the Development Services Committee and staff for putting these putting this together and making changes. I know you've been going back and forth for quite some time. So I don't have any issues with it. And my question to Matt would be, what are the next steps if the council chooses to adopt? Establishing a public hearing.
Yeah, the next step is, if everybody's okay with the way it is right now, next week we'll bring a resolution that will schedule a public hearing. And I would schedule that for, unless you have a different time frame, schedule that for December 3rd. And at that point, can either make a decision to approve it that night, or you can talk about it at a subsequent meeting. But what I'd recommend is, if we're okay with the way this is, I will get that resolution to schedule the public hearing necessary for this ordinance to be adopted and bring it back to the next meeting.
Okay. Bill, anything else?
Yeah. A question first. This is on the books already, correct? In its unmodified form?
No.
Okay,
but I think at one point there was.
At one point it was, and then it came off. Right. I just wanted to point that out to Joe, that this was brought to the committee by the Planning and Zoning Commission because they felt that the tools in the toolbox of the enforcement officer weren't working properly. And they're the ones that had initiated the initial edit to reintroduce this part of the ordinance. The committee then kind of worked with the commission to make some further suggestions. And I think what our committee ultimately did was add that layer of fairness to make the process a little more objective. And again, take out the enforcement officer's concerns about liability or treble damages and so forth. So that what I felt we came up with is a very workable tool for the things that are obvious and that consistently come up as complaints. And for me personally, you know, hearing a lot of complaints about illegal businesses in particular, and the some of the unfair practices that occur in the community that could never really be addressed with the existing ordinance, but at least now there's a tool to engage some of these entities and make sure that the folks that are operating at Enfield and who have, you know, the businesses that we have here are on the same playing field with everybody else. So that was the reason why I saw this as a great opportunity for the committee to add some input to the Planning and Zoning Commission's initial suggestions. So, yeah, I look forward to a good discussion with the public at the public hearing. And, you know, if it needs more work, I'm sure Councilman Edgar and Councilman Stokes are up to the challenge, too.
Councilman Stokes?
I let Bill speak because he's the chairman of our committee, and he's done an excellent job, and he is someone who, even beyond our time, spends time reviewing these things or whatever. The biggest issue for me was the some type of an appeal process, and so that made me happy there, though. But I'm happy with our work, and once again, listen to the public, but I think we did a good job putting this together, so.
Thanks. Anyone else? Okay, so we'll have an public hearing resolution on the next agenda. Okay. That completes items for
discussion. It'll snow that night.
Yeah. Don't say that. That completes items for discussion. The next, we move to miscellaneous. The first item under miscellaneous is the consent agenda. I know there were some questions put out on the first item of the consent agenda. What we'll do is we'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda and then open it up for discussion. So is there a motion to approve the consent agenda by Councilman Mangini? Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilman Stokes. Discussion, and I emailed out some questions from our caucus to you, Matt.
Yes.
In regards to the transfer of funds for community development, $6,250.
Yes, and let's see, kind of working backwards with some of these questions here. Peter Bryanton had provided answers to the questions. Regarding the last two questions that were asked, which were, have fines been canceled upon a property coming into compliance? If so, what is the total dollar amount of these canceled fines? The response back was, if a citation is issued, the only way fines could be canceled out is, one, if a hearing officer is requested and the hearing officer decides the case is not valid. Two, a hearing is requested and the hearing officer gives the violator more time to comply. And the third is violations are completed and the town is notified within the 10-day appeals period. To date, we only have one such case in which the violator was given more time to comply. There are no other cases where fines were canceled out. And so the question then, if I can find the answer here, is what are the fines? And according to the finance department, there was $3,600 in fines from last fiscal year that after the audit will be transferred to the community development budget under the clean and lean. Right now, according to the enforcement team, that there is about $10,000 of fines on two properties, which is yet to be assessed by the hearing officer. So $3,600 from last year in terms of fines that can be now moved into the clean and lean fund. And there are two properties right now outstanding with fines of about $10,000 that once it goes through the hearing process, we'll know what that number is going to be.
Okay. Does that answer all the questions that were sent? I know there was a question on could the fine revenue be used in place of the general fund transfer.
Yeah, I think, you know, ultimately there will be more money moved in, but we just, at the time, we didn't have the ability because they hadn't finished up with the audit yet, and so we don't have those numbers to actually roll it into that. and we have those two outstanding. So it could ultimately be a decision that if council wants to, we make this, and then when you know all those things are done, you can back it out and transfer it back into the general fund to reimburse that. But at this point in time, to get these things kind of taken care of, because it's showing a little bit of red in our budget, and we'd like to get those taken care of.
And right now, those funds are allocated to the clean and lean. So a fine goes into the clean and lean fund.
Right.
To help clean up other properties.
Yeah, the issue was last year, we didn't have that fund set up, so the money just went into the general fund effectively. So once we get all the audit done and it says, okay, this money is available for that, we can then move it in.
Okay. So anyone have any questions, comments on the consent agenda on any one of those two items? Okay, sensing none, I need a show of hands. All those in favor of the consent agenda? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Those opposed? 2 opposed. So the consent agenda is adopted. 6-2. Next is the appointment town council appointed for the housing authority. Is there a nomination? Ken.
I'd like to nominate Bill Ballard. He's been on the committee. He is a huge part of this committee, and they speak very highly of him. His attendance is great, and I think he contributes quite a bit, and I'd like to renominate Bill Ballard.
Second.
Okay, motion by Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Stokes and Councilman Kensler, and to reappoint Bill Ballard. Is there a motion to close nominations?
Motion to close nominations.
Motion by Ken, seconded by Councilman Mangini. All those in favor of closing nominations by a show of hands. Those opposed? Nominations are closed. Any discussion? Councilman Stokes.
As the liaison to the Housing Authority, we had a meeting a while back with them, and it's a great group of people. They have a great heart for what they're doing, and Bill Ballard definitely is somebody who is passionate but also very knowledgeable and articulate, and so just want to thank him and the rest of them for their service, because sometimes these are the kind of commissions and groups that we don't see a lot of acknowledgement of, but they work hard for our community. So just want to thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Any further comment? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Kinsler?
4.
Councilman Lee?
4.
Councilman Mangini?
4.
Deputy Mayor Nelson?
4.
Councilman Stokes?
4.
Councilman Arnone?
4.
Councilman Bosco?
4.
Councilman Edgar?
4.
Mayor Copen?
William Ballard?
Just 9 in favor, none against, and no abstentions.
Next item is discussion resolution request for transfer of funds for youth services DFC grant, $125,000. Resolved that in accordance with Chapter 6, Section 8F of the Town Charter, the following transfer is hereby made to youth services DFC grant. Full-time salaries, $43,383. Part-time salaries, $2,089. Police overtime, $7,019. Stipend, $1,193. Medical dental, $6,606. Life insurance, $250. Social Security, $2,901. Medicare, $679. Other professional services, $47,137. Postage, $295. Printing and reproduction, $250. Office supplies, $555. Technology supplies, $300. Material and supplies, $678. Food, $400. Travel, $10,890. Dues and fees, $375, for a total of $125,000 from the DFC revenue, DFC grant, $125,000. Certified, the funds are available. Lynn Nenny, Director of Finance.
So moved.
By Councilman Mangini, seconded by Councilman Kensler. Any discussion? No discussion. Roll call, please.
Councilman Kinsler?
4.
Councilman Lee?
4.
Councilman Mangini?
4.
Deputy Mayor Nelson?
4.
Councilman Stokes?
4.
Councilman Arnone?
4.
Councilman Bosco?
4.
Councilman Edgar?
4.
Mayor Copen?
4.
It's 9 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Thank you, Gene. Next item, discussion resolution Christina. Authorizing the town manager to enter into an agreement with the Capital Region Council of Governments. This is the first of three. Be it resolved that the Enfield Town Council does hereby authorize the town manager to sign, enter into, and amend any agreements with the Capital Region Council of Governments, CROG, specifically related to a grant for the study of zoning in the Thompsonville section of Enfield under the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development's HUD Sustainable Communities Regional Planning Grant Program.
So moved.
Second.
By Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Mangini. Discussion. Matt.
Just briefly, you know, this is something that is very necessary related to the overall economic and redevelopment goals we have for the Thompsonville area. You know, I think it was said earlier today that practically, if not all, properties within Thompsonville right now are non-conforming. They do not conform to what the zoning code is. And for any redevelopment or development to occur in there, it's near impossible. And so with the funding that was granted the CROG through the federal government and their Sustainable Communities Regional Planning Program, we're able to get a lot of work done that, one, will help us figure out what the appropriate zoning uses, allowable uses within the Thompsonville area, which, by the way, is one of the goals of the Plan of Conservation and Development. But it also worked to help instill a sustainable community concept and a transportation-oriented development concept in an area where we're going to be planning to build a transit center. So, you know, it may be what some people think, just another study on top of a study on top of a study. But this will actually get us, one, to reach a couple of the goals through the Plan of Conservation and Development in terms of, you know, sustainable communities, as well as actually zoning the property the way it should be zoned, not the way it is zoned, but also, you know, do some market analysis of what type of businesses and development can occur in Thompsonville as part of that overall transportation-oriented development concept.
Thank you, Matt. Questions? Councilman Mangini.
Thank you, Matt, for the synopsis. I think it's very important that everybody understand. Certainly, I'll be supporting these resolutions, but I'd like to offer to offer the waiver for the readings because they're all relative to the first. And, Scott, you've already read the first.
We have to take them one at a time
when
they come up.
Okay. Then can I make a motion to waive the second?
Not at this time.
Okay.
Because you have to wait till the item comes up on the agenda.
Okay.
Sorry.
Signal me, and I'll make
a
motion.
Okay. But they're all different resolutions.
Right, but they're all relative to the same.
Correct. Councilman, sorry, Deputy Mayor Nelson.
I just think that, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but shouldn't we get a direction we want to go in Thompsonville and figure out what type of development we want before we start putting zoning regulations or changing zoning regulations down there?
I'm not going to correct you because you're 100% correct, and that's exactly what we're going to be doing.
That's what the study's about.
Yeah, that's the whole intent behind this, is a process that will develop exactly what should be going on down there that then yields what the proper zoning should be for that property. And so it's you know, this process is something that, you know, is going to be engaging of people, not just saying this is what we think. They're actually going to do the research and understand, you know, what can happen. Because, you know, again, we may look at Thompsonville and see it a certain way, but, you know, what we see may not be realistic. You know, we may have some people say, let's tear everything down and build up these big buildings. Well, that may not be a viable thing to do in Enfield, in this part of the state. And so you have to have an understanding of the marketplace of what can be done here before you start saying, well, let's zone it all for large-scale development. That doesn't make any sense. And so this money is being put in place so we can study that and come up with, you know, what should the expectation be, and then bring the zoning in to support that type of development.
And who does this study?
What do you mean?
Who's the one who's going to determine what's best for Thompsonville?
Well, we're going to be working through staff and CROG with the company a little bit later on, the next resolution, I think it is, to allow me to sign a contract with the Cecil Group And we do have staff here that interviewed them. If you want to come forward, maybe just give a little background very briefly on the Cecil Group.
Good evening. We did have a panel of...
This is Jose Geiner, by the
I'm
way.
I'm sorry. Jose Geiner, Director of Planning. We did have a panel consisting of Ray Warren, Peter Bryant, and Darren Lamore, myself, and Mary Ellen Kowaleski from CROG do the interviewing. We had some very good panelists, and the Cecil Group out of Boston, Massachusetts, came out as the one with that had, I thought, the right approach to it. They've had a lot of experience along both in Massachusetts and Connecticut down to Metro North areas of looking at neighborhood zoning around transit centers. So,
and could you maybe just kind of flesh out what is the process they're going to be handling?
Well, yeah, and there's a scope of service. Obviously, what the big questions we asked of them was exactly what Matt was saying is we want something that's going to work, not necessarily what we think is. You know, we've done zoning. You can put a bunch of regulations in place and not get any kind of response from the development community or the residents. So one of the things they're going to be doing is doing a lot of outreach to people, both stakeholders in the area and also public forums, charrettes. There's the reason we chose the Cecil Group is they had a very strong marketing component of their team. They had a market analyst that said basically he's going to look at every single property and try to determine what the market analysis for that property is, so we can fit the zoning to what the reality is out there. And also not only that, but also be able to be flexible enough. You know, the transit center can take up many different forms. We don't know when the state's going to come through with their rail. If we put all our eggs in one basket with zoning, that might not be good either. And their approach was they can, you know, they've done layered zoning where they can say, okay, here's the first phase that, and if the next phase comes in, this is what you want, what can happen here. So the Cecil Group, among the groups that we interviewed, came out with, you know, far and above the best, I think unanimously from our group as the top consultant to do this work.
I guess my concern is, and I've been pretty vocal about it, you know, we spent over $250,000 on a train station that doesn't exist. We don't even own the building yet. We spent $200,000 on a house I believe was on the market for $100,000. Just the direction that we're spending money in Thompsonville for nothing to happen, it's got to stop. That's why the town or the state of Connecticut's in the condition it's in. And if we're going to move forward, I'm all for moving forward. But the direction we've been moving forward hasn't moved anything forward. It's just wasted a lot of money. And, you know, private development would never waste money like this. So that's why I'm trying to, I guess maybe if it comes more out of the municipality's hands and goes into somebody who's, you know, got a stake in the game where it's actually going to cost them if this doesn't work, because that's the problem is nobody's got anything to lose by spending all this money in the grants and stuff like that. People say, you know, it's free money. It's not free money. The state's $300 million, and we're going to get another tax increase. You know, and that's not what this is about. But what I'm saying is I think we need to be better stewards of the money, and I'm just very concerned because the past has not been too promising. So, I mean, Jose, if you can tell me that this is going to go in the right direction and you're sure of this and, you know, the town, that zoning is going to work down there, without having a developer in place who says, you know what, I would like to do this. Because to me, that would be the first move is find developers who are willing to invest their money down there and then see if the zoning works for that. Because the town or the state can't keep creating development because it doesn't work. I mean, that's proof all over the country. So I'm concerned. I want to do this. I want to see improvements in Thompsonville for everybody, but I don't want to keep throwing money away. I'd rather give it back to the state of Connecticut and say, put it towards your deficit. So convince me.
Well, if I could real quick, it's federal. It's actually coming from federal government.
Federal.
So
okay.
Yeah, not the state. They wouldn't give us money like that. We wouldn't see it very, very quickly if they did. But I think, you know, again, the intent behind this is exactly what you're saying. granted, you know, we don't have the developer right now, but it's kind of hard to attract a developer without knowing what can be done. And I think, you know, the history has shown that people aren't stepping forward to do that type of redevelopment right now. And as part of this study, understanding, and one of the things that we're being told is that the zoning is so restrictive that it's very difficult for people to come and spend that money and get a return on it. So why spend the money? And again, as part of this, if we can get the proper zoning that will allow, you know, the highest and best use of the land rather than the use that's there and that's what you're stuck with, I think we'll start seeing people, you know, step forward and saying, you know, probably not in large mass saying, you know, here's a $100 million project. That's probably never going to happen. But if we get, you know, a lot of $50,000 and $60,000 projects, it's probably even better because we are getting local people investing and they have, as you said, more skin in the game than somebody coming from the outside. So it, you know, we could easily get into a chicken and an egg. You know, why don't we have the developer first then do this? Well, the answer is because developers are telling us that they can't spend the money because it's not zoned the way that they need it to be zoned. So again, as part of this, we you know, engage those you know, developers that are out there. We engage the people that own the properties. We engage the elected officials. We engage the average citizen that's going to, you know, ultimately either pay to live there, pay to buy it, or pay if there's you know, a commercial establishment there. And we get, you know, going forward saying this is what we as a community are willing to put in there. This is how we're going to zone it. So now, Mr. Developer, now, Mr. Investor, invest the money and let's get going. But you know, I you and I have talked about this, I know, in the past. You know, I agree with you. We do a heck of a lot of studying. And this is a different type of study where we actually, if everything goes right, you know, we can get engagement. We can get people interested in these areas and actually get something going on rather than just talk about, you know, 20 years from now what we should have done 20 years ago.
Right. So. We have talked about it, Matt. Yep. And if you're saying that this is going to go in the direction which I believe we should be going down there, I will support it because I think that's the direction we have to go.
Yeah.
You know, private development is what's going to create a likable market in Thompsonville. There's no other way around it, you know? I mean, government, you know, shelters and stuff like that, that's not going to bring the people down there. So I will support it because we've had talks yeah. about this.
And
so.
I think, you know, one of the things we did, the state had put out, I think it was four or five, what they call transit-oriented development planning grants. For some reason, they didn't give us one. But you know, that one was a lot more elaborate. It was about $250,000. And, you know, we were going to be looking more at a larger development concept uh-huh. that, you know, would allow us to piece together, you know, larger pieces. You know, this one's not going to get there, unfortunately, and it's still another, you know, thing that we would like to do. And if the state decides to do something like that again, you know, we're going to be right there knocking at their door to do it. But again, this, I believe, will get us closer to where, you know, what you're saying, that reality we need to be at. It gets it closer. You know, will it get people to do something? You know, as you know, it's going to be a function of the economy and what the return on the investment is going to be. People are spending, you know, as council knows, people are spending money on development projects in Enfield right now. You're not seeing it in a lot of areas, but you're seeing it here in Enfield. And, you know, what we're now trying to do is redirect it into the Thompsonville area and give the tools necessary to the developers to be able to make that return on their investment. And again, when I say developers, don't think big people. You know, they're your neighbors. Uh-huh. You know, they're people that want to see the best thing for the community that you know, go in and say, I'm going to buy that house and I'm going to make it something that you know, the community can be proud of.
Right.
That's really who we're talking about, that at the end of this process, you know, we're going to see. Those are the developers. They're not, you know, multimillionaires that are sitting there saying, let's go throw $10, $15 million in Enfield.
Right.
It's our neighbors here in Enfield, most likely, that are going to have $30,000 or $40,000 in addition to their acquisition of the property. And it's happening now. I mean, you go down in Pleasant, you see it's taken a few years, but you see a very large former multifamily commercial establishment that has transformed and still being transformed. I mean, that's what we're talking about here, is giving people the ability to get a return so they spend money like that in Thompsonville.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Jose.
All right. I got a lineup. So I've got Councilman Arnone first, Councilman Stokes, Councilman Kenzer, Councilman Mangini. Go ahead, Tom.
I support this, and I think, Matt, you said it all. The climate has to, it's up to us to make the climate right so developers come in, because as long as I've lived here, I haven't seen the developers come in. And I'm sure they're out there, but until we make that climate the right climate. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Greg?
I had a lot of the same concerns that Kenny had. In this study, are they also going to be analyzing our zoning policies and processes? Because I know that you can zone everything, and then, but if you folks come into the business, say for instance, we get this study, we want to change zoning, and somebody comes in and says a whole different idea than we even thought, that we have to change usage. You know, I mean, the red tape sometimes can be a headache and turn people off. And the reason why I say that is what I do for a living. We're looking for property. We've been looking. And a couple of towns, Enfield being included, we've avoided because the steps to go through to get to change the usage for a church is, and I know that's not a taxable, so that's probably not the most favorable thing you want in town. Obviously, folks want church, but we don't make money. But I also know a couple of towns have just one phrase in there that says that any zoning in their town can be adjusted to church or a religious institution. And that's all, it's one line. And so what I'm saying, I'm not saying it for me, but if we do all this or whatever and somebody comes in, I think part of the problem is the process of getting something changed for usage so that we can entice them. And so is that going to be addressed in this, too? I don't know for sure.
I think that's, again, that's 100% of what we're trying to do is you know, we've seen people that want to spend money and renovate properties, but it's not zoned properly for the usage or the type of use that they're trying to do. And so you're right. To go through that process is a labor that you know, they look at and say, I'm just not willing to do that. If this is successful and does what we're saying it's going to do, it's going to right zone those areas that, you know, we think, you know, should be the type of developments to go there. And so they're zoned properly, so you don't have to go through that long process of getting a use change or trying to shoehorn something in that, you know, really isn't anywhere within the code.
Okay.
And so that's what the goals of this project are, is to get the proper zoning so people don't have to go through all those, you know, all that red tape to get a project that probably, if you ask everybody, would be a good project to do.
Yeah, I just, you know, I think about a lot of things because I come from Detroit, and I'm not comparing Detroit with Thompsonville or whatever, but Detroit is a city I grew up in. I was on the Board of Education, the suburbs there and stuff, and everybody had their ideas of what it would take, and my problem always was that there was not a major vision for the whole corporate area. And that's one of the problems with Detroit was they were always trying to piecemeal, and they had a vision for this section, or they catered to this, but there wasn't really something where everybody in the community could get your eyes upon and have a time frame to where you're actually gonna try to complete these things. Because businesses coming in, they wanna know what your vision is and what your plan is for the future for the whole area. They wanna make sure once they invest, they don't abandon you. That we don't abandon them. So those kind of things come to my mind, so. Yeah.
And I'd kind of put this in a comparison that it would be like in our industrial commercial park, if everything was zoned residential, and understanding what it would take to get that zone to be commercial is monumental. And so in Thompsonville, we have areas that, again, are zoned R33 that don't conform to R33.
Right.
Thompsonville's R33. And so we take that off the table. So it's, you know, it's not to say that there may not be those uses that we can't even conceive of right now that may not be proper for certain areas that may never, you know, be changed, or we can't change the zoning to allow for that. But it may be something that we don't want to begin with anyways.
Right.
But the things that, again, the community can say, we think these are good things to have built, you know, good uses within, you know, a very dense, densely populated area, you know, let's get the zoning to allow for those type of uses right now. And that's what, again, this project will do is, you know, through an analysis of the market, you know, say this is possible, this really isn't possible. And that then points us towards the type of zoning that we need in there.
One last thing, I'll move off myself. When this goes all done, is this something that we'd have a major presentation on that the community we could publicize? I definitely want to make sure we have that. So, okay.
Yeah, because there is a component of change in all this, because in the end, you know, we're going to have to change zoning. And there's, and again, that's not in a slam dunk. That's
a lot of
education and engagement to get there.
All right, you have my support tonight. So thank you.
Thanks, Greg. Tom?
Yeah, I'm going to support this. And I agree with Deputy Mayor Nelson on the concerns, and I think you've put those aside. I also think that I hope that after this, it'll also help us in other areas of town in the way that they are zoned or miszoned or need to be looked at again. So I think we can only obviously benefit in Thompsonville, but I think it will take us across the whole scheme of things. So I'm fully in support of it.
Thank you, Tom. Cindy?
Thank you, Scott. Matt, I just want to compliment your synopsis of the procedure and the process. Looking at the CECL, planning and design outline, if you will, it looks very professional and detailed. But I also want to stress the fact that supporting our town staff is my position here. You know, we've got Jose, we've got Peter, we've got Ray, and those gentlemen have always directed us in the right direction and taken us down the right road. And I certainly have a lot of respect for their expertise in this field. But I think that at this time, our direction should be to go forward and put the money out there and try and figure out where do we go with our zoning rules, especially in Thompsonville. Because, you know, it's not one size fits all down there. So I think it's important that we go forward and do this. But I do want to support our town staff because they've given us the direction that we need to be able to make these decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Councilman Bosco.
Yeah, Matt. HUD went in there and destroyed Thompsonville. Can you assure me that by doing this study and doing what's here, we're not going to destroy Thompsonville even more than it is? And it won't be a detriment. It will definitely be a positive.
And will you take all the blame?
Yes, I will take all the blame. I think that's what I'm supposed to say, right? I've been, this is my fourth community, and practically every community that I've been in has their story of urban redevelopment. I mean, and it's not any different here than it was in those other communities. You know, what I'll hesitate on saying that it was a bad thing or a good thing, because, you know, we have the luxury of looking back now and being able to say it didn't work. You know, at the time, there was a lot of money that flooded the local, you know, municipalities in the states. And there was a desire to be different than what had been there for hundreds of years. And so they made a lot of poor choices. I mean, again, that's looking at it today, saying they made a lot of poor choices. You know, ultimately, the decision makers make those choices. You know, ultimately, you're the decision makers.
And that's why before I make my decision,
right,
I err on a side of caution, because I'm really not for it. Maybe I'll change my mind.
Well, let me just say the one thing that they didn't do, and again, it's uniform through every community I've been in that had that urban issue back in the late 60s, early 70s, is they didn't look at it from the standpoint of what you as a business owner would do to make a decision. There was a lot of money. They had to spend it very quickly in government terms over a 2 to 3 year period. There was very little, thought process given to does it make sense or doesn't it make sense. I mean, I can take you, I can take you to a mall that was built in the early 70s in a community that is, you know, if you go by there today, well, maybe not today, but if you went by there, let's say 10 years ago, you would think is a large prison in the downtown. And you say, my God, what did they do? But, you know, back in 1972 when they built it, that was a kick-butt thing. It was incredible. you know, to have a mall in the downtown. But, you know, a lot of history went down because of that. And that happened here. I mean, a lot of history was lost. We're trying to give you a tool as the decision makers that can make a good decision so we don't have to repeat, you know, what is perceived as a poor decision today. And so that's what we're giving you. We're not giving you a silver bullet. We're not giving you something that's going to go out and tear buildings down or build buildings. We're going to give you a set of tools to try to make good decisions going forward. And that's what zoning's about, is giving you the ability to make good decisions. This is what this study will do. I mean, again, if the Cecil Group does what we expect to do, if our staff performs the way we expect them to perform, it gives you the ability to make good decisions. And that is all that you're going to get at the end of the day, is something that will give you the ability to make good decisions. What you do with that, well, you know, that could be a bad decision, but, you know, that's your decision.
All set?
All set.
Thanks, Joey. Councilman Lee.
It's probably one of the best discussions we've had on Thompsonville in quite a long time, and I think what is exciting about these resolutions is that it finally puts into action some of the stuff, as Ken was alluding to, that has been sitting around as ideas for a long time. What we're attempting to get started here tonight is exactly what Cindy probably recalls was part of the revitalization, you know, checklist from back in 2005. And even then we recognized we'd had a series of studies, we'd had a series of visions, really putting the technical expertise to work to come up with, you know, not necessarily a blueprint, but the next steps was really what we were lacking. You know, we've known for a while that we've kind of desired the village atmosphere. We've known for 15 years that we've wanted to make the neighborhood kind of, you know, transportation centric. We've known for, you know, 20 years that we've kind of placed some value on historic preservation and the architecture and the history of the, you know, the Mill Village. And we've known now for, you know, a dozen years or so that we're trying to take advantage of being river focused or having, you know, the chief asset of our community kind of in focus in what we're doing in the village. So I'm thrilled that we're at this point. And in looking at the Cecil Group, you know, they appear to have history with brownfields. We have those. They've got history with various design, you know, design guideline requirements and preservation requirements. We've got those needs. They've got a history with waterfront development. We certainly have that. So I'm thrilled with your choice that staff has made. I think this is a kind of a watershed step in, you know, the renaissance that we've been trying to kickstart. So I don't vote for this, thinking that this is going to be, you know, the end-all, be-all step. This is really the next one that really kind of gets things to a point where the technical specs can be looked at, some changes can be made, the community remains engaged, which I think is probably one of the biggest pieces, and we can stay true to the goals that we set to keep things moving and in the right direction. So it has my support 100%.
Thank you, Bill. Any further comment? Just for mine, I support it. This is one of the initiatives and the benefits of working with CROG. And tomorrow, I have a policy board meeting, and one of our resolutions states the following. Whereas pursuant to Connecticut General Statute Section 32.325, Regional Economic Development, the Connecticut Department of Economic and Community Development is authorized to extend financial assistance for economic development projects. And whereas it is desirable and in the public interest that the Capital Region Council of Governments makes an application to the state for $350,000 in order to undertake, in partnership with the Enfield Community Development Corporation, a project to acquire, assess, and remediate the property located at 33 North River Street, Enfield, and to execute an assistance agreement. So on multiple facets, CROG is helping us with our redevelopment efforts in Thompsonville. So, and I'll let you know, I don't foresee any problems at CROG, but that's what active participation in CROG gets us, is their willing partnership working with town staff, working with the state to help us realize our goals, especially in areas such as Thompsonville. So any further discussion? Sensing none, can we have roll call, please?
Councilman Kinsler.
Four.
Councilman Lee.
Four.
Councilman Mangini.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
Cautiously, four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
Extremely four.
There's nine in favor, none against, no abstentions.
Recklessly.
I'll vote for it also.
Oh, did you skip?
I'm sorry, I
that's
did.
That's okay. In here.
Yeah, you did, and I wrote it that you were here.
That's fine.
Optimistically four?
Wholeheartedly.
Wholeheartedly four. Okay, we move to the next item. And Cindy, they're very short resolutions, so it won't.
You don't mind reading?
Yes, because it will take longer to waive readings. Be it resolved that the Enfield Town Council does hereby authorize the town manager to sign, enter into, and amend any agreements with the Cecil Group, specifically related providing consultant services to the town under a grant for the study of zoning in the Thompsonville section of Enfield under the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development's HUD Sustainable Communities Regional Planning Grant Program. Motion by?
So moved.
By Councilman Mangini, seconded by Councilman Kinsler. Discussion? Since we had it with the first one. Roll call, please.
Councilman Kinsler.
Zealously, four.
Councilman Lee.
Four.
Councilman Mangini.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
Again, cautiously, four.
Councilman Krog.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
You like this one. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Really?
Really.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
And the next one is resolved that in accordance with Chapter 6, Section 8F of the Town Charter, the following transfers hereby made, such funds to be automatically reappropriated for fiscal year 2014. If the study is not completed by the end of this fiscal year. Two, Thompsonville Zoning Study, purchased professional and technical $50,000. From General Government Grant, CROG Grant Revenue $50,000. Certified the funds are available. Lynn Nenny, Director of Finance.
So moved.
By Councilman Kinsler, seconded by Councilman Mangini. Discussion? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Kinsler.
Regular four.
Councilman Lee.
Yes.
Councilman Mangini.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
10-4.
Councilman Crowley.
Four.
Councilman Edgar.
Four.
Mayor Copen.
Four.
There's 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
That completes miscellaneous. Next item on the agenda is public communications. Is there anyone in the audience wishing to address the council? Mr. Cruzell. C-A-U-G-H-T. Remind anyone speaking to the council 5 minutes. Please state your name and address for the record, and please refrain from the use of personalities.
I thought it was 3 minutes in a second time, but
we'll give you five, Walter.
Walter Cruzell, 21 Charney Road, Vice President, Peerless Tool and Machine, 5 Peerless Way. I just want to continue what Councilman Bosco said in his in his comments, which was hours ago, I guess, but anyway, that our Representative Kiner and also our Representative-elect Alexander do remember that taxes cannot go up. They just raising taxes to correct Connecticut will not work. We've seen it. They got to cut the spending, like you said. I am prepared with some notes tonight. I wanted to give you a Peerless Way tax update for this year. Peerless Way is paying in property taxes alone $154,000. To date, over the 14 years that Peerless Tool has been at Peerless Way, they've paid $453,000 on property that paid $800 a year back in 1998. So that averages to $32,000 a year. So I got no more to pay. So don't raise the taxes. That's all I got to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. Public communications. Anyone else wishing to address the council? Sensing none, Councilman Communications, Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Through the mayor to the town manager. Matt, can you give us an update on that house on South Street? Is it sold for sale? What is the outcome of that?
Or Peter? Hello, Peter.
Good evening.
You thought you'd stay off camera.
Well, I just put on my coat because I thought we were done.
Well.
So did Scott.
Absolutely.
Peter Bryanton, Director of Community Development. The house is on the market. It has been on the market for about 2 weeks now. There was an open house last Sunday. I believe there was another open house coming up soon. The house is on the market for, I believe it's $139.9. Anybody interested, give us a call. Community Development, 253-6391.
That's great. I mean, that's a deal of a lifetime right there with the money that's in that house. This is a plug for you, Peter. I mean, people are missing out. I mean, I don't know if there's any first-time home buyer money left, but they could also use that. This house qualifies for that, right?
Right. Unfortunately, we don't have any first-time home buyer money from the town side. However, the Community Development Corporation could provide some gap financing if necessary.
CDBG.
It's a win-win for somebody looking for a home. I mean, it's a great opportunity. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further councilman communications? Sensing none, is there a motion to adjourn?
So
by
moved.
Councilman Lee, seconded by Councilman Mangini. All those in favor? Those opposed, we are adjourned. Have a good evening.